We all have our faces glued to our digital screens, raising my hand and guilty as charged. These habits, as you know, hurt our relationships. My guest who's with me this morning founded the world's first user experience and digital product firm development. He's now a reformed technologist, working to enhance the ways that we communicate and collaborate, not only personally, but professionally as well. And it's great to welcome Anthony Franco to WCTC Radio this morning. Hi, Anthony. It's Burt Barron. How are you today?
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
My pleasure. You know, social media plays such a role when it comes to relationships. And I don't know if it's made us, they call it social media, Anthony, but I feel like it's made us more antisocial than anything. Did you experience the same thing?
Yeah, I think you're actually dead on there. So we're becoming, the studies show that we're actually becoming less social. We're attending church 20% less. We have 30% fewer neighborhood friendships. And our socialization at work is down 60% as compared to the time before social media. So it absolutely is waning. It's anti-social media.
Yeah, and you just look at the changes of things around us that it's impacted. I mean, we're noticing, Anthony, you're not fooling anybody when, you know, movies are shorter nowadays because it's hard to keep people engaged for such a long time. Baseball, of all things, they're trying to find ways to speed up baseball because it's hard to keep people engaged because everybody wants to stare at their phone. The detriments to the basic human connection caused by the smartphones and technology, it's incredible. I don't know if we're ever going to dig ourselves out of this, Anthony. Is there hope for the human race going forward?
Well, look, social media companies, in my opinion, are mostly bad. They allow me to stay connected to the people that are distant from us, but it's also absorbing. So look, they're incented not on connectivity or even privacy or truth. Social media companies make money on engagement. That's their business model. And engagement is just a fancy word for addiction. Why do you think social media companies call their customers users? They have algorithms designed to addict you so that they can drive more ad revenue. It's until we can snap out of that addiction, it's bleak.
Yeah, it really is. And you heard before I brought you on the air here, what was I doing? I was telling people to go to YouTube and watch a video,
yeah.
Right? So it's like when you're not listening
it's
or
not
watching us live.
Bad.
No, you're right. You're right. Yeah. There is upside to us, obviously. And you want to talk about some tools, some online tools for businesses, and talk about what that's about and the impact that has on disconnect and this business version of social media. I'm fascinated to learn about that.
So social media in the workplace, employers have incentives to have their employees work from home because it costs less and it gives and their employees enjoy that autonomy. But it has an expense of collaboration and creativity. And in a time where emotional EQ is really the differentiator, social and ways of collaborating online are actually pulling away from our ability to collaborate like we all kind of are used to. Like the best ideas come in a room with a whiteboard and post-it notes.
Yeah, have you noticed that? You're right. You put up something on the wall and you write on it, and that's where the great ideas are still generated from. And it's remarkable to me, and Anthony, I'm sure you feel the same way, about how fast we have come in such a short period of time. You got to remind people, it wasn't that long ago, all we had was phones with cords hung on walls, and that's all we had. And it's remarkable how quickly that's changed.
Yeah, and the upgrade was a longer cord.
Yeah,
right.
You're right. That's exactly it, right? From dial-up internet to basically all the technology and all the information in the history of the world logged in our back pocket. It's incredible how quickly we've come. And I like to think that things, when it comes to just the basic human relationship, Anthony, hopefully it can be salvaged. I'm hoping that it can be.
Me too.
That would be nice, right? Is there a direct correlation? What do you see in your study and your research, particularly when it comes to school grades? Do kids who spend a lot of time on the smartphone and chatting with friends and gramming with their friends, as they call it nowadays, is there a connection between performance and school? I mean, does typically a technology addict do poorly in school based on this, the raw numbers?
Yeah, so schools are actually partially to blame here because schools are touting this notion of one-to-one. And what that means is that every student gets an iPad or an Android tablet, which isn't, again, it's not entirely bad. Those devices are great for doing research. But when you look at the way we like to work and learn is in social environments. When you put an iPad in front of somebody, they might as well be sitting alone in the living room. And so we're gaining more knowledge potentially, but losing a lot of wisdom. My company, I used to be an entirely tech focused. I focus now on just very analog products, whiteboards, and we have a little square whiteboard that we're now handing around to students in schools. And just removing the technology and handing them a tool that they can use to think on has increased passing grades by 340%. And overall test scores by 40%, and it's an analog thing. So,
Wow. So
research is great with technology, but learning and collaboration really happens in real life. As they say on the internet.
There's no doubt about it. No, you're right. And you don't give a student a tablet, like you said, and said, oh, here you go. This is going to lead you to hours of isolation and depression and unhappiness. You give it to a kid so that it's like, okay, well, you can do your work on here and learn a few things. Like you said, we don't learn anything, because anything we want to know, we can just look up in a second without having to learn or memorize anything. I think that's been one of the biggest changes.
You're absolutely right. And Generation Z, which is really the only generation that's grown up knowing only social media and technology, their depression's up, their anxiety up, and believe it or not, with social media, their loneliness is up. So it's good to figure out ways to where we can limit for our children and our kids that addiction into social media. If you can do it.
I'm trying to remember, was it BuzzFeed a couple of weeks ago, Anthony? Maybe you saw this in the news, that just for a gag, they actually handed out printed newspapers, and they're saying, oh, this is our new platform. This is where we're going to be sharing information. And people were like, this is great. The battery doesn't die. It's got all the current news in it. I can just hand it to someone else and share it with somebody. It was remarkable watching these 20-somethings get a newspaper handed to them and like, what a great idea this is. Why didn't I think of this? And I just couldn't help but crack up at that. You did see that, right?
Yeah, I saw it. And, you know, it's like, hey, is this? Can I trust this? It feels more trustworthy because it's on paper.
Right.
Yeah.
So it might not have the spontaneity that online news has, but here you go. You don't have to worry about a dead battery. You're not going to be charged and tethered to a wall. You don't have to charge the newspaper, right? I really wonder where we're headed next, Anthony. It's really interesting. And now smart speakers. And I'm always telling people, you know what? Hey, listen to our radio station on your smart speaker. You know, set up the skill. And whether you got one in your home, your office, the kitchen and bedroom are popular places now for these smart speakers. I'm driving people to these as well. And I could see another sort of isolation component with this, because all you will want to do, there are people right now that sit around and all they do is fire questions at their Alexa waiting to hear the answer, right?
Yeah, we got to be careful here not to sound like two old white guys or two old guys, you know.
Well, we
you
are,
know,
right?
These days, like we got to be careful of that.
I know.
Because in newspaper times, people would say, and during the printing press was seen as a really disruptive, dangerous technology. So it's not that technology and progress is bad. It's just the problem that we're having is technology, as you stated before, is advancing so quickly that it's hard for us to understand the social impact and the impact to humanity before the next thing comes out. So we're not. I don't know what the answer is. I just know that I've stopped using technology less and whiteboard and post-it notes way more.
Yeah, good for you. Maybe that's the way to go.
Yeah.
That would create more of a, forget about the anti-social media, it would kind of bring people together. Imagine knowing your neighbor's name and the names of the kids and when their birthdays are again, instead of like putting it in your phone. And, oh, let me look it up on my phone. I know I got it here somewhere. But where can we go, Anthony, for some more info on you? Because I think you're a fascinating guy with a lot of stuff to offer. And about these little white squares, these whiteboards you were talking about. Where can we get some more info on that?
Oh, yeah, so I'm on LinkedIn.
Of course.
Anthony Franco. my company is called MC Squares, and we make dry erase products that help people collaborate.
Imagine that, a face-to-face discussion with somebody and sharing ideas. How refreshing, right? Remarkable. Anthony, thank you so much for the time today. I learned a lot from you, and I don't know where we're going to be 10 years from now, but we will be where technology wants us to be, right?
Exactly. Yep, I agree.
All right. Good talking to you, Anthony. Thanks for the information.
You too.